So I really can't believe this is happening, right? Derail. Awesome. As some of you know, Derail was actually inspired by the LIS Ed Symposium, which was coordinated by graduate students at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. In fact, one of the coordinators is actually here in this room today. Madison Sullivan! Which is amazing. I mean, it really just warmed my heart because it's all about community. And that's what this is community and all of us. That's what we've created today. And I think at Simmons in general as well. So Madison, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you for doing this, it's awesome.
So I attended the LIS Ed Symposium virtually, and I was completely blown away by what they were able to achieve. And I thought we should do this at Simmons. But I never thought that it could happen. And honestly, it's really this entire team up here, they're amazing. I feel really, oh my God, I hope I don't cry. It's okay to cry though. I'm very grateful for this team and for all of you for being here, for attending, for presenting, for volunteering. Amazing. Also, of course, I have to acknowledge our sponsors, the LISA, the Library Information Science Students Association, and the ALA Student Chapter, PLG, and ACIST, and of course, the School of Library Information Science, particularly Dr. M. Claire Knowles, who has helped us a lot. Am I forgetting any? And Spectra, all right, great. And the Students of Color XLIS, which is a new organization that was created last semester, so very excited about that. So as for the purpose of Derail, we wanted to steer the focus towards topics that are not typically highlighted in our classrooms, and yet are at the heart of LIS, diversity, equity, race and racism, accessibility, and identity. So our discussions tend to focus on information, the circulation of it, the preservation, and also the tools and technology that we need to work with and access information, right? But people tend to be left out of those discussions. And from my perspective, information and technology are social constructs. We create information, we create technology. Why would we leave people out of those discussions? We have various identities and they intersect each other. And so when we work with other people and other communities and our colleagues, we need to know more about how that works with information and technology. So that's Derail. And now I want to introduce you to this amazing group of people behind me, or alongside of me. I'll start over here with technology. They are the reason why we were hooked up with technology today. Boom, yeah. So now we have Jahan Sinclair. She is our archivist. I'm gonna end with these two. Jesse, all about registration. And we've got Nancy Loy, who's the acting LISA president. Woo! For the semester. She's our finance coordinator and plus everything.
She
made sure
that I was. Yes. There's more food.
We've got Irina Rogova, social media extraordinaire.
Commenting all the time.
Yes, and volunteer coordinator. And we've got Mackenzie Mullen, who is responsible for all of the graphics, the signs, They're amazing, right?
Yes.
Powerful, and yeah. So, and we have Des Alaniz. Okay, have you received emails or anything? It's all her. She's
just
amazing.
Just
total, total wordsmith, and yeah, love you. And we've got Caroline Gardner, the project manager and event coordinator, also shoulder to cry on. And last but not least, Nicole Kuna, who is our accessibility coordinator. So I'm going to hand off this mic to them. But yeah, if you would like to applaud for them, that'd be cool.
I am pretty self-spoken, so let me know if I need to talk a little bit louder. I just have a few policies for the folks in the room today. I'll just get started. This doesn't apply to the folks at home, but please bear with me. So first of all, please be aware of everyone's space and if they desire to be touched or not touched. If we have anything that's triggering for anyone, let us know if we didn't say anything or if you have questions. And then also, we have a perfume policy to not wear anything scented, as any some folks may be sensitive to smell. And last but not least, in the hallway where the food is today, we have a quiet room. So if you need to take a break or just need to unstress, things like that, feel free to go there, move around during the presentations, whatever. So I'm going to pass it off to you, Caroline.
Hi, everybody. I just want to repeat what Chris said, and thank you all for being here. Thank you for being online with us. This started as conversations in hallways, and then a bunch of people sitting at a table saying, can we make this happen? And now we're here, so it's really exciting. So I have just a couple of general guidelines to go throughout the day. So this is a safe space for everybody. So get up when you need to. There's plenty more space in the room. Leave. Take a walk, take a break, run to the restroom, get some water. Water is important. Get some coffee. Don't feel like you're going to be rude or judged if you need to get up and leave the room. Not going to happen here. And as far as questions throughout sessions, we just ask that you raise your hand. And virtual presenters and also people here, if you don't want to speak out, you can tweet your questions to @LISEdForum. You can also use the hashtag derail2016. And then if you want further anonymity, there are post-it notes on all the tables and a bunch of pens that you can drop off at the social media table, which is in the back, and they can ask the question for you. Additionally, there's feedback forms on all the tables. If you are comfortable filling them out for each presentation or any presentations that you like, it's all anonymous, we'll collect it at the end, and it's used to give presenters and ourselves some feedback on the day. There's also going to be photographs taken throughout the day, so if you don't want to be photographed, it's no problem. Just let us know and we can let our photographer know. She's right here. also, these, sort of this seat here and that seat there, might be on camera, so if you have a problem with that, you can shift or move. Which also leads me to anybody with volunteer or planning crew on their name tag can help you. We're a pretty collective, cohesive group, so if you have any questions, concerns, needs, whatever, short of running up to buy you ice cream, we can help. also for presenters, keep an eye on Joyce if you can, because they will be giving like 10, 5, 1 minute warnings. Just to keep things running smoothly and on time. I just also wanted to ask if in-person people can make sure your phones are on silent or vibrate. Just, you know, be the like movie phone guy who tells you to turn that off. other than that, just also remember to enjoy yourselves. We're dealing with some, you know, in-depth, tough stuff, but try to find some joy in the day and take care of yourselves. And I think that's about it. Anybody have any questions so far? Feel good? In that case, I'm going to dive right in and start by introducing our very first presentation of the day. Yay! So for our first session, we have Jesse Young, who is presenting Inknography, Challenging the Model Minority Stereotype with Tattoos and Oral Histories. So here she comes. I created my interviews in Boston and Los Angeles, so I did
Boston for 3 months, and then I went to LA for 2 months to do my project there. So it was a lot of fun to meet with a lot of different people. So these are my narrators. I interviewed 22 people, and I'm still going. I have one interview next month, who represent the diverse Asian American community. And I can't go over everybody's identities, but my narrators are art teachers, biomedical engineers, students studying graphic design, politics, neuroscience, and pre-vet. They're writers, they're social workers, and there is a library. They identify as Chinese, Korean, Cambodian, Indian, Filipino, Vietnamese, Taiwanese, and multi-ethnic. And they range from undocumented to 16th generation American. So my process. There are many steps, and I hope you learn from my mistakes. And I hope that this allows you to take the right direction. I had to get my project approved by the IRB in September. There are a lot of legal issues connected to oral histories about privacy and security and accessibility, especially since my project was open to the public. I mean, if you type in ethnography, that could have some really good, let's get you to the top of the page of Google. I don't know what that's called. Sorry, Celeste. and especially on a tight budget, this was really interesting to do. But you have to think about privacy and security, and especially since tattoos are personal identifiers, they are going to be really connected to that person, and it can be used against them in the wrong ways. So I had a really long waiver that was approved. So my second thing I did was outreach. Social media was my best friend. I met Dor Zhang, a researcher in LA, who did almost the same project as me, but it was about Asian American women and community identity. And she's in Boston, but she was also from LA, so we had that shared identity. I used Facebook, and I believe there was a post in the queer Asian American community, and they were extremely, extremely welcoming to me. The issue is that the queer Asian American community feels very invisible right now, and they really reached out to me because they really want to preserve their experiences and voices, even though I was focusing on such a narrow group of people. I used the Simmons College ARC, where I got to meet a lot of undergraduates. I talked to my old advisor at my undergraduate school, who helped me get in contact with undergraduates at my undergrad in Los Angeles. And I didn't want to pressure anybody to talk with me, so what happened was, I put a post out, they would email me, I would ask them for a bio, I would create an interview guide, they would okay it. Then we would schedule a meeting, and we would talk to about 45 minutes, and sometimes they went on for like 2 hours. So it was a really great experience to learn from so many people, and it was very individualized, so it took a long time to do. So after scheduling time, I used a GoPro, actually, to record, because that's what I had, and I didn't have time to learn a camera and to have somebody watch it for me, and I was doing this all by myself. So a GoPro was very useful because it has a little more flashing light, so I knew when I was recording. I was also really paranoid, so I also had a digital video, digital voice recorder next to me to record, just in case. And it did come in handy because one time my camera did shut off. So always have backup. It was so stressful. You're trying to sit there and you're trying to like, oh, is my camera recording? Is my phone off? It was just so stressful. But I utilized the services around me, so most of my services were free, like my digital voice recorder was from Simmons Technology. I was also able to get a tripod from them, and because I was traveling to Los Angeles, I came up with an agreement with them, and I was able to rent it for a month. So it's really flexible. It just talk to people and tell them why they must support you. You must do this for me. I made copies of my interviews on my computer and my hard drive. It's a lot of memory. I think my biggest file was like 20 megabytes. I don't know. It was really big, and it took off all of my computer, and it was just really stressful, and I couldn't do homework that night. So it is standard, after doing your recording, to do transcriptions. But transcriptions take a really long time. It takes about an hour to transcribe 15 minutes of actually recorded speech. And I have Dragon Speak. I got it through the Simmons Grant Fund to transcribe my materials. However, it takes a really long time to format because you have to listen to it, and Dragon Speak spits out text blocks. So what I'm planning on doing is if my interviewer, my narrator wants it, I will transcribe it and fix it. But if they don't ask for it, then they're not getting it until I'm done with graduate school. So after recording, I use more free software here at Simmons and on my own computer. I use iMovie and I save the unedited and edited version and use a lot of hard drive space. And I edited using GarageBand. So it took a really long time, so if anyone is doing this project, don't interview more than 20 people, interview like 10. it took 2 hours to edit a video, which is, could be like an hour long for me. Another hour to convert it into a file, and then 2 hours to upload it to YouTube. And then you have, and if your computer was slow like mine, it took longer to transfer your files to your external hard drive, and everything was really slow. And so it actually got to the point where I was rendering my files at work and then uploading stuff at night when my roommates were sleeping, so I wasn't slowing down the internet. Plus, you have to listen to the interviews to create your own metadata. So after all materials were gathered, my advisor, Wong Tang, and I explored different platforms to make my items accessible, and we got to Omeka after looking at WordPress, Flickr, Google Photos. And Omeka is a free open source content management system for online digital collections. I know that Digital Libraries uses that software. Phew, okay. And Omeka uses an unqualified Dublin Core metadata standard, and I've kind of altered that to my needs because I didn't do too well in cataloging, but it just fits what I need. So how to catalog materials. One of my biggest issues was I did not want to narrow my narrator's identities. You know, for me, I was talking to them because they were Asian and tattooed, but that does not describe anybody as a whole in any possible way. And their tattoos was a really problematic thing to catalog, in my opinion, because, you know, the tattoos come in different sizes, there's stories behind tattoos, they come from, they put them all over your body, they are very personal and hard to describe without context, and I did not want to minimize their inspiration. So that was really an interesting battle. So here's an example of what I ended up doing. This is from one of my narrators, Scott. So I chose to make the title, the object, the narrator's name. The subject is black, which was the style of the tattoo. I put the description after the style. So Scott here got a train track from the graphic novel Persepolis, which is a representative of movement of life, which is really hard to say if this is what inspired it in your metadata. So I'm going to go back and fix it. I mean, everything has notes. I just have to go back to my meta and figure out how I want to word that properly. So a lot of my narrators were artists, and this is like, you're probably a better photographer than I am, or you have like artist photographers. You can do this. So like, yes, I do. And so they just have to donate images to me so that they wouldn't have crummy pictures that I would take. So that's why his name, or their name, is under contributor. Identifier, I decided to put their state, the city we talked in, and the West Coast, because there's a West Coast, East Coast portion of this. And then I put some additional tags that I thought would be useful. And so, like I talked about how identities was really hard to address. And so I decided that I would figure out that later. Sorry, I'm like in the middle, I just learned Omeka. I'm placing the identities in the source section under the oral histories of videos. So that is really gonna be interesting. And I hope it works out because I do not want to change the identities. So I'm gonna show you for the first time my project. So this is my collection. It's still under construction. There are many blank pages, so don't look yet. But all of my digital items are here, and it's searchable. So we can find videos and images at the same time, and you can browse them separately. So we're gonna look at one item. So I type in the word pop. And this is Diana's file or item. She was a really cool narrator to interview. She was actually arrested during a Black Lives Matter protest and got her arm broken by police brutality. And so it was really interesting to talk to her, and searchable in those images, and I hope that everybody can browse it one day and it'll be accurate to the narrator's identities. So it's a common experience for Asian Americans to have experienced stereotypes and comments like, all Asians look alike, and I recently heard at work, don't all Asians know each other? That's actually not funny. Even the term Asian to me is very problematic, and it bundles identities together into one type of person. My project reveals a rich diversity in the Asian American community, and the mainstream culture often forgets. Besides hearing fun stories about tattoos, my project examined how Asian Americans experience a model minority myth, racism, and struggles in balancing their American and their Asian identity. I hope this collection will make people think before they make a joke about Asian Americans. And I know that this happened very recently at Simmons College, where somebody made a joke about suicide and the law in Asian, and it did not fly under my radar. Simmons should hold students accountable for these racist jokes, as it alienates your students of color. And it must be very embarrassing for Simmons to have their students talk like this, and sending out uneducated, immature students into the world with a Simmons attached to the name. I hope my collection will act as a tool for Asian Americans to learn how to turn a microaggression into a teaching moment. I would really like to thank these people and York for you for paying attention. and here are some of the people who've helped me the last 9 months. Thank you.
did you ever interview anyone who maybe felt that tattoos had a criminal meaning or anything along those lines to try to get a counter perspective?
Where they did feel like it was a criminal? No, a lot of it was people expressing something that they, you know, really did love and wanted to permanently express that. But many did express that their family, and this is across the board in every culture, that their family felt it was attached. And I do have a narrator who did admit that they did have relatives who had tattoos that were attached to gang life. So, not in my areas, maybe I should have reached out to that cousin though.
Any other questions?